United States may be the most prosperous place on the planet, but does that make Americans the world's happiest people? When you figure in the well-being of citizens, just how successful is it?
A lot of us are very neurotic. Doing, 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 doing. TV, phones, text, phone.
I think across the board, Americans are happy, and if they aren't, I think they should look around and consider that they're lucky and should be happy.
While financial security matters, studies show the happiest places aren't necessarily the richest.
I'd say there's good weather, we're happy, but if it's like really bad, it really influences our mood, and then we can be really
happy.
If
it's raining outside, I'm a bit like...
Here at the United Nations, efforts are now underway to put personal happiness on the international agenda. While a nation's progress is typically measured in financial terms, economists are beginning to acknowledge that doesn't take into account the well-being of its citizens. The Himalayan nation of Bhutan, rated among the world's happiest places, is behind the international effort. For 40 years, it's based its development on a concept known as gross national happiness.
It is based on the belief that human beings have needs far more than just material or economic alone. And so it is about balancing the needs of the human individual in terms of the material as well as the social, emotional, psychological needs.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Balvin. I'm Darko. Okay, so we just saw this little propaganda piece put out by Al Jazeera. Basically trying to promote a happiness index coming out of the United Nations or global government. Well, it was kind of interesting, just a quick point, that they use the Himalayans as an example for happiness, because to me personally, that was a propaganda piece because they're trying to promote austerity or poverty as being happiness. And you talk about, oh, it's not always economic, financial freedom or whatnot that leads to happiness. It's, you know, political and religious freedoms. Well, let's just go to the place that they talked about or use an example as being the happiest place. Well, the Tibetans, which are in the Himalayas. Two more Tibetan monks self-immolate in China. This is a big phenomenon. It's been going on for a while, but in the past year, there's... I've been more than 30 of these immolations setting, setting yourself on fire in protest to try to get attention. Yet the United Nations has not addressed this at all. So they really don't give a flying freak about happiness. It says here, it was staged in little more than a year. So 30 self-immolations in more than a year, nothing's been done, except you're seeing on TV that you should care about these rebels in Syria. They're being armed by the West and Israel to go in there and kill military members of Syria, the Syrian government. So it just goes to show you where the prerogatives or priorities are. This is my website, ggnonline.com. I just posted a new poll up here. It's been a little while, but will people alter their cell phone activity after the, quote, revelation, that's a revelation for some people, that service providers are helping governments track its customers? So will people change their activity after knowing this? Well, so far 1% said no. So you can go there and check it out. I'm going to keep moving now. I'm ready to go. This is a story that's been in the news. Pensioner shoots himself at Greek parliament, refuses to search for food and garbage. So a 77-year-old Greek man has committed suicide in central Athens by the nation's parliament, shooting himself with a handgun in apparent financial desperation. Eyewitness reports say the man shouted, quote, "So I won't leave debts for my children," end quote, before turning the gun on himself. Others claim he said nothing. The incident occurred around 9 a.m. local time, just outside the train station when the square was filled with people and commuters. The man took his life behind a big tree, which concealed him from most eyes. A suicide note has been found on the old man saying that the government has annihilated all traces for his survival, and since he cannot find justice, he can't find another means to react besides putting a decent end to my life or to his life before he starts searching the garbage for food and become a burden for his children. So you can go there and check that out. Brief follow-up from the AFP. The occupation government has literally wiped out my ability to survive based on a respectable pension, which I had paid for during a 35-year period, the pensioner said in an excerpt published in Greek newspapers. I find no other solution for a dignified end before I start sifting through garbage to feed myself. So, okay, moving on here. Greek woman sat on building ledge for over 5 hours threatening to jump. Remember this story when I covered it from February 15th, 2012. She threatened suicide to protest losing her job under Greek austerity, i.e. poverty cuts. So, you know, the banker's got a lot of money and you're going to have to bite the bullet on that one. So, rebellion spreads. EU elites have miscalculated. For those who missed the story about the retired pharmacist who killed himself in Greece, it goes on and it says, it is a call to arms, a poignant moment in Europe's unfolding drama reminiscent of the Buddhist self-immolations of Southeast Asia. Ooh, nice parallel there. It says here that so captured world attention. His suicide note refers to the regime under Axis occupation of World War II. So he goes in there and he says, we've entered perilous waters in Europe. Greece is not an isolated case. He goes on and says, variants of the Greek tragedy are unfolding in a string of countries as they embark on similar policies of self-feeding contraction, as well as become clear over the next 2 years. Spain's youth unemployment is already 50%, according to the UK Telegraph. So the Daily Bell's free market analysis is, we have often written that the power elite's reaction to the internet reformation is one that will not be entirely successful. The suicide of this individual in Greece may perhaps support this contention. And one thing that I forgot to mention was what he said towards the end, which was some of the notes called for an uprising of the people, sacking of the government officials, basically the traitors, I think he referred to them as. And back to this article. So there's an interesting aspect to this, because I wondered if this was being promoted by the elites as far as psychological warfare, you know, to put it out there, you know, we humans, we tend to mimic each other, right? And then they have the, what is it, the 100th monkey syndrome or something. Basically, people try to emulate themselves or emulate other people. So I was just wondering if this was supposed to be a message to everyone. Part of austerity, i.e. going into poverty, is just going ahead and offing yourself. And it's said here, that on one side you have the vicious austerity, on the other you've got people offing themselves. Now perhaps the idea is to reach a middle ground where the Greeks will exist as a cowed and miserable people, just not miserable enough to either rebel or commit suicide en masse. But he goes, there's no evidence that the suicide was staged or that the suicide note was forged. The authors of the Daily Bail figure the promotion is simply more of the same. It's part of the kind of dialectic that the elites like to establish to control the conversation, manipulate society towards the desired ends. They basically go on and say that it's similar with the internet. They may not have really wanted it, but now that they have it, they're going to try to use it and control it and manage the information flow. Just an interesting side note here. I noticed today, just around where I'm living, you know, that there was all these young people, I guess they were out of school because of Easter break, and they were having like this wrestling melee out in the middle field in between the two parking lot roads. And I'm like, what the hell is going on here? And the first thing I thought was what? Was Hunger Games. And I heard one of them say something about, oh, we're going to play the mother game or something like that, because then they started pretending like they were getting married. It was kind of freaky. But they were out there for about a good 30 minutes, I think, if not more, out there just having little wrestling matches. And then the girls were just kind of like eventually like cheerleading, and they were the fans and stuff. I almost wanted to go up and ask them, but I'm just like, I better not. But yeah, so, you know, they're emulating what they see. And they don't even know that that was programming directed towards them, towards the future generation, which is to accept this austerity and get ready to go into this kind of battle royale situation where the economy's dead and people are just basically, especially the young, are just kind of thrown out to the wolves. But it's just so scary. It really is that they would accept the programming that's there to hurt them, right? So moving on here, we have the next Great Depression. MIT study predicting global economic collapse by 2030. So you don't need to have a PhD at MIT to predict that there's going to be a global economic collapse. So I'm just going to leave it at that. You can go in there and check it out. Along with this, 45 signs that America will soon be a nation with a very tiny elite and the rest of us will be poor. So I have a lot to get to still. So you can go in there and check this article out. World food prices rise further, raising fears of unrest. So yeah, it goes on. It says global food prices rose in March for a third straight month with more hikes to come. The UN Food Agency said on Thursday, adding to the fears of hunger games, hunger, and a new wave of social unrest in poor countries, right? Like the United States, right? No, we're rich, right? So, and according to the double think that we were just taught, the poor countries are happy and the rich countries are sad. So, it says here, Americans brace for next foreclosure wave. So, moving on here, Canada ups retirement age in bid to balance budget. So, it goes on and says, blah, 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 government, as if there's a left and right, calls for the retirement age to be raised. So, it doesn't really matter whether it's left or right. You're supposed to learn that you are supposed to fit a role, to be a good little slave and work until you drop. And then your pension won't be there anymore. Ha, 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 that's the big joke on you. So it says here, U.S. adds 120,000 jobs. Unemployment falls to 8.2%, which is a bunch of crap, that number 8.2. So, but it's supposed to make you think that everything is getting better. So it says here, the big miss, 120,000, expectations of 205,000, unemployment at 8.2%, not in labor force at all time high. So it says the unemployment rate drops to 8.2%. So celebrate everyone for one simple reason. The number of people not in the labor force is back to an all-time high. Moving on, we have disappointing jobs report revives talk of Fed easing. So yeah, we may have to go to the Federal Reserve to get some laxatives. And it says here, at Federal Reserve buying 61% of U.S. debt. Remember that? It's propping up the entire U.S. economy by buying 61% of the government debt issued by the Treasury Department. Speaking of which, basically, the Treasury Department is the manager. They are the go-between between the Federal Reserve System and their slaves, their livestock, i.e. you, with your Social Security number that you're working off. Well, you're working off debt that was incurred from 1933 after 20 years of the Federal Reserve System being incorporated. You were put on collateral, and he's the manager of that collateral. So he's urging our sellout trader Congress to back the International Monetary Fund, basically the global government's own little private bank. It says here, IMF, global economic recovery far from robust. So IMF chief calls on U.S. for more cash. So that's why you have Geithner, your sellout, to saying that. And we do contribute most of the money to them. Jobless young people that go to third world countries and enslave them, take their resources. And so it goes on and on and on and on and on. So jobless young people could be forced to live with their parents and denied housing benefit to cut welfare costs. So yeah, it says here, but thousands of unemployed youngsters are claiming housing benefit through a loophole the government is hoping to slam shut. So Nicolas Cage pays IRS $6 million. I saw this, and the first thing I thought was that was the condition people to say, you know, everybody else is paying their taxes. Look at our programming icons in Hollywood. They're paying their taxes. Maybe everybody else is. Well, a new bill in Congress could suspend your passport if you owe taxes to the IRS. It's called the Highway Trust Fund. Senate Bill 1813 allows the government to suspend your travel outside the country if you own taxes. It was passed in the Senate last week and is going to the House. IRS commissioner says paying taxes is a pathway to citizenship for illegal aliens. So, of course, they want to expand their tax base. So, moving on here, we have Minnesota waitress sues after police seized $12,000 tip. She was looking for a miracle to help her struggling family and having financial problems, but police went and seized a $12,000 tip that was left on her table, saying that it was drug, which is kind of funny because the police are notorious for stealing people's drugs and then implanting them on people and stealing their cash and their firearms. So DeWitt Roll Your Own Cigarette Shop sued by state already shut down. So people are trying to avoid these packaged cigarettes, trying to roll your own. Well, they left in the middle of the night because the feds are coming after them for evading taxes. Next up, we have church forced to close at Easter for the first time in its history after being plagued by thieves. And D-Day hero 89 mugged for his 200-pound pension by two thugs who followed him home from a bus stop in their car. We even have a Chinese boy who's selling his kidney for an iPhone and iPad. No joke. Then next up, we have Van Jones Group plans Americans Arab Spring Revolt. Remember in Egypt, it actually left radicals in charge of the government, so maybe that's what they want here. But Van Jones calls libertarians basically racist bigots. And remember, in January, the DHS was doing what? Oh, a mock, you're not getting your Social Security benefit check. And they had the feds there ready to take care of the sheeple. TSA set security checkpoints at Tennessee way stations. TSA police worked together at the Amtrak station. Remember DHS putting in the contract for all those 223 rounds, indefinite amount, shelters, direct builds, bulletproof boots for Homeland Security. And lastly, DHS to grant illegal aliens unlawful presence waivers. Thank you.